Welcome to St. John's Lutheran Church, Springfield, Ohio. Today is November 13th, 2016. This is the 26th Sunday after Pentecost. St. John's is located at 27 North Wittenberg Avenue, Springfield, Ohio. Our telephone number is 937-323-7508. St. John's has a food pantry open every Wednesday, 9 to 10:45. An outreach store open 9:30 to 1, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, and Friday, closed on Thursdays. Rainbow table, a dinner for everyone at every Friday, noon to 1 o'clock. Please join us for our services at 8 o'clock and 10:30 every Sunday. We have a midweek service on Wednesday night, 6:30 in the chapel. Communion is first and third Sundays of the month, festivals, and all holidays.
Good morning. And welcome to our worship service this morning. We give a special welcome to our visitors. If you're new in the Springfield, Clark County area or looking for a new church home, we invite you to make St. John your new church home. We begin with the order of confession and forgiveness on page 94 in the front of the red worship book in your pew. So I'd ask that you please turn to page 94, and I invite those who can do so without difficulty to please stand. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
God of all mercy and consolation, come to the help of your people, turning us from our sin to live for you alone. Give us the power of your Holy Spirit, that we may confess our sin, receive your forgiveness, and grow into the fullness of Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
Amen.
Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another. Gracious God, have mercy on us.
We confess that we have turned from you and given ourselves into the power of sin. We are truly sorry and humbly repent. In your compassion, forgive us our sins, known and unknown, things we have done and things we have failed to do. Turn us again to you and uphold us by your Spirit, so we may live and serve you in newness of life. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
Amen.
God, who is rich in mercy, loved us even when we were dead in sin, and made us alive together with Christ. By grace you have been saved. In the name of Jesus Christ, your sins are forgiven. Almighty God, strengthen you with power through the Holy Spirit, that Christ may live in your hearts through faith.
Amen.
We now begin our worship with My Hope is Built on Nothing Less, hymn number 597, in the back of your worship. Hymn number 597.
This hymn was written by Edward Mote in 1834 Edward Mote was an Englishman, a carpenter. He wrote most of his hymns when he was doing carpentry. Became a minister in the Baptist Church when he was 55 years old, and he ministered in the church until he was 71. This is his hymn. Edward Mote was a great hymn writer while he was a carpenter living in England in 1834. This hymn was written.
Thank you.
through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
You may be seated as we listen to the reading of God.
Today's reader will be Steve Clark.
First reading for today is from the fourth chapter of Malachi. See, the day is coming, burning my beloved, and all the arrogant and all the evildoers will be stubble. The day that comes shall burn them up, says the Lord of hosts, so that it will leave them neither root nor branch. But for you who revere my name, the Son of Righteousness shall rise, healing in his wings. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Becky Dimitrov will be doing the song.
Pastor John Pollock is preparing to read the gospel for today. St. John's Lutheran Church, Springfield, Ohio, November the 13th, 2016, the 26th Sunday after Pentecost.
Teacher, when will this be? a sign that this is about to take place. And he said, beware that you are not led astray, for many will come in my name and say, I am he, and the time is near. Do not go after them. When you hear wars and insurrections, do not be terrified, for these things must take place first, but the end will not follow immediately. Then he said to them, nation will rise against nation and kingdom against kingdom. There will be great earthquakes, and in various places famines and plagues, and there will be dreadful portents and great signs from heaven. But before all this occurs, they will arrest you and persecute you. They will hand you over to synagogues and prisons, and you will be brought before kings and governors because of my name. This will give you an opportunity to testify. So make up your mind not to prepare your defense in advance. For I will give you words and a wisdom that none of your opponents will be able to withstand or contradict. You will be betrayed, even by parents and brothers and sisters, by relatives and friends, and they will put some of you to death. You will be hated by all because of my name, but not a hair of your head will perish. By your endurance, you will gain your souls. The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. May you be seated. A couple of announcements to share with you. First of all, of course, this week is our Yuletide Festival. They are thanks to all those who decorated the trees yesterday in the atrium and in the gym. Also, there will be more set up going on tomorrow, Tuesday and Wednesday, so if you can volunteer some time to help with the setup for Yuletide, your presence will be greatly appreciated. Also, to help with the Yuletide on Thursday, Friday, and Saturday morning. Also, reminder of our Thanksgiving service on Tuesday the 22nd at 6:30 p.m. here in the chancel. Once again, we ask, as in the past, that you bring non-perishable food items to restock the pantry. Once again, this past week, our pantry was hit by a lot of people. There were 68 individuals that were killed. But that's not counting their family members. And some had families as large as 5, 6, 7, 8 people. So you can just keep multiplying that 68 by 5, 6, 7, 8. It's an awful lot of food that goes in and out here on a Wednesday morning. So please encourage family members, friends, neighbors, whomever you know, co-workers, to join us for our Thanksgiving service and to bring non-perishable food items so that we can replenish and keep food in the pantry. And one last announcement, it's not a change, it's simply something different than we've done in the past. At 8 o'clock, we sang When Peace Like a River, also known as It Is Well With My Soul, hymn 785. We will sing that during the collection of the offering. So I will announce that after the Apostles' Creed. We will sing that. It's such a beautiful song of our faith. So during the offering, we sing When Peace Like a River, or It Is Well With My Soul, as it's also known. Now, as such, please give your attention to our choir.
Special music by the Chancel Choir led by Vicki Perks.
Oh,
Grace, mercy, and peace to you from God our Father and our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. This morning, I want to speak with you more than preach at you. Something heavy has been on my heart, and the Holy Spirit I felt all week was driving me to speak with you about this matter. So first of all, I'd ask that you take out your sermon notes. And you notice that the sermon text is not one of our lessons today, but is the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 18, verses 21 through 35. So if you have your Bible, you can open it to that passage, or if you want to use one of the pew Bibles. The reason that I felt the need to speak with you today is, as you're well aware, we just finished Tuesday, or more accurately, at 3 o'clock Tuesday morning, one of the most divisive and nasty presidential campaigns that I could ever remember. The first campaign I can remember was in 1956. I was 5 years old. My family and I were in the city of Cincinnati for some reason. And a bunch of sirens started, and I asked my parents what it was, and they said, well, it was Abby Stevenson's motorcade that he was running for president. He'd given a speech in Cincinnati, and they were rushing him off, I guess, to the airport. But the first campaign I really remember was Nixon and Kennedy in 1960, and then everyone since then. And as I say, I don't remember any that had been so divisive and nasty as this one was. So much so that I know too many instances where family members or friends, in the passion and in the heat of this campaign, said things to one another that has called them to have a fracture in their relationship. That has caused people who have been best friends, family members, who have loved one another, to not be speaking to each other, all because of the passion of this past campaign. Now that it is over, it is necessary that we, as the brothers and sisters of Jesus Christ, enact that command of our Lord to forgive. There is a motel chain that you're well aware of, Motel 6, that has it, that phrase, "We'll keep the light on for you." Well, what our sermon text for today says, as we're going to take a look at it in a minute, is telling us that God's light of forgiveness is always on for His children. That no matter the situation, no matter what has transpired, that light of forgiveness is always there. And so as we look at our sermon text this morning, we see, first of all, Peter coming to Jesus with the age-old question. Then Peter came up and said to him, "Lord, how often will my brother sin against me and I forgive him? As many as 7 times. How many times should I forgive?" As human beings, we have a natural tendency to think there should be limits on everything. Limits especially on those things that are merciful, things that are out of the ordinary. So without the influence of Jesus Christ, most human beings would think that forgiving somebody 1 or 2 times is enough. If they hurt you after that, then you write them off. And that's what happens in the secular world. People will forgive maybe 1 or 2 and that's it, and then they'll have nothing to do with someone. But Jesus is saying to those of us who are His followers that we're called to live a different way of life. We are called to enact a different standard. No matter how much we are hurt, Jesus said to him, "I do not say to you 7 times, but 7 times 70. So what Jesus' answer is telling us is there is no limit on forgiveness within the community of faith. In other words, you and I are to forgive each other over and over and over and over again. stupid things we say, no matter what stupid things we might do, we are to forgive. In Hebrew, the month of Hebrew 7 was a number of completeness, the perfect number. So when Jesus says 7 times 70, he is saying that there is no limit on forgiveness, that it is to be go on and on again. So then he says, therefore, the kingdom of heaven may be compared to a king who wished to settle accounts with his servants. By this, Jesus is telling us what the purpose of this parable is. The purpose of this parable is not salvation. He's speaking to believers. He's speaking, when he says the kingdom of heaven, he's speaking of those of us who believe in Jesus Christ. And therefore, what we already have salvation through our faith, so what he is speaking about are our personal relationships, not with him so much and God the Father, but with each other. How are we as Christians to act towards each other? How are we to interact with each other? And so then he gives the example of the king who wants to settle accounts. The first servant is brought in. He owes the king what would be worth like $5 million. And obviously he can't pay it. And so the king is saying he's going to throw him in jail and sell his family and all these horrible things. And the servant says, have patience with me and I will pay you everything. That word patience means to hold back anger for a long time or to exercise understanding. So the servant wants understanding. He wants mercy. And what Jesus is telling us then is to be right with God, we have to be right with our fellow believers. It's not enough just to have that right relationship with God through a personal relationship with Jesus Christ. It means we also must have the right relationship with each other. And the cornerstone of that relationship is to forgive. Forgiveness. So, but when that servant came out, he found one of his fellow servants who owed him 100 denarii. That would be like $50. So he owns chump change. He owns something that could be paid off in a couple of weeks. And he says, he seized him, he began to choke him, saying, pay what you owe. So his fellow servant fell down and pleaded with him, have patience with me and I will pay you. He refused and went and put him in prison until he should pay the debt. When his fellow servants saw what had taken place, they were greatly distressed, and they went and reported to their master all that had taken place. Then his master summoned him and said to him, you wicked servant, I forgave you all the debt because you pleaded with me. And should not you have had mercy on your fellow servant as I had mercy on you? And in anger, his master delivered him to the jailers until he should pay off his debt. I forgave you. The word forgave, or as I have it on question 7, forgiveness, this literally means unmerited favor or pardon from a debt. And further, that's a simple answer you can fill in. Receiving unmerited favor or pardon from a debt to you. Its more detailed meaning is the undeserved releasing of one from something that might justly have been inflicted upon them or extracted from them. So to forgive is to give something to someone that, if you look at it strictly from a law point of view, would be justly afflicted upon. In other words, if we are talking strictly by law and not by the gospel, then we as brothers and sisters in Christ would be just in extracting something or afflicting our brother and sister in Christ who we felt has harmed us instead of forgiving them. But that's not what the king says. The king says, I showed you this unmerited favor. I pardoned you from this. You should likewise do it to others. So from this we learn that forgiveness comes from God to us and then from us to others. That we don't withhold forgiveness within the community of faith. Remember, Jesus is talking to believers here. He's talking to those of us who make up the church. So no matter what was said in the heat of the election, no matter how passionate you were for one candidate or another, if someone hurt you or you hurt someone, forgiveness needs to be practiced. And you don't necessarily wait. If you feel like you've been hurt, you don't necessarily wait for the person who hurt you to make the first step. Because earlier in the Gospel of Matthew, Jesus gave us the example of if you come to the altar and you're going to offer your sacrifice, and you remember that someone has done something to you and you have bad feelings toward them, that you are to leave your sacrifice at the altar and go to that person and initiate reconciliation. In other words, you are the one that initiates reconciliation with that person who hurt you, or said something mean to you, or said something that you did not think was respectful. Now, in some cases, a person who sinned will come and initiate the reconciliation themselves. So if they do that, then you have the responsibility to accept that forgiveness. And not to say, no, I'm mad at you, I'm not going to forgive you. See, this is the greatest blessing the church has. The greatest blessing of the church, its defining gift, is that of forgiveness. See, in some of the world's religions, they live by eye for an eye. In some of the world's religions, they do not talk about forgiveness. And nothing hurts God our Father more. Nothing hurts our Lord Jesus Christ more than to see his followers angry with each other over things that in the true picture aren't really bad. Our nation has had election after election and it still is churning along as it always has. In 1960, when President Kennedy ran, the first Roman Catholic to run for president, some of you will remember the horrible things that were spread about him, that if he was elected, his allegiance would not be to the United States, but would be to the Pope in Rome. And that America would no longer be ruled by the Congress and the President, but by the Pope in far-off Rome, dictating what we should do. Well, John Kennedy got elected, and the Pope stayed in Rome, and John Kennedy stayed in Washington, D.C. And I know of no decision that John Kennedy ever made that he called the Pope up first and asked his advice or his instructions. And so, when we look at the broader picture, is it really worth holding a grudge? Is it really worth continuing to be mad at someone? Is it really worth not being reconciled? For as the King said, as I forgave you your debt, you should have forgiven him his debt. Instead, so often, being sinful human beings, we think we're justified, saying, well, that person did worse to us than we did to them. And so, we have a right to stay mad. Again, that tugs at the heart of Jesus Christ. He looks down and weeps to see his church in anger with one another. When you think back to that first Good Friday, 30 A.D. or 33 A.D., whatever scholars now, whichever date they favor the most, it bounces back every so many years. But when you think of Jesus hanging on that cross, when you think of him going through that horrible act of crucifixion, when we read of all that was done to him before he was even nailed, and to think that he went willingly so that we could be forgiven for the sins that we do. Is it really worth fighting over what color carpet is going to be put in the sanctuary? Is it really worth fighting over what have to think, what does Jesus Christ say? And it's no different when we keep grudges over an election or over a sporting event, over any other things that go on. In the big picture, they're not that important. I don't care who gets elected president every 4 years, because my faith is not in who's elected president. My faith is in Jesus Christ. And my faith is that as long as we as a community of faith pray for our nation, that Jesus will keep blessing us and watching over us. So we must practice this most defining gift of the church, the gift of forgiveness. C.S. Lewis, the great Christian writer of the latter part of the 20th century, said in speaking of forgiveness, everyone thinks forgiveness is a lovely idea until they have something to forgive. And as you're sitting there this morning, reflect upon yourself. Think about how often that is true. We all think forgiveness is wonderful when we hear the preacher preach about it. We all think it's wonderful when we hear Jesus tell us that God forgives us and that we are forgiven as we are forgiven. But when we have an incident where we feel that we've been harmed or we've been hurt, then suddenly forgiveness doesn't sound like such a good idea. Believe it or not, I know you won't believe this because pastors never fight with their wives, but when Gina and I have a strong disagreement or something happens, there are times when I'm angry with her and I say, God, I don't think I should forgive her now because she did this and that's not comparable to what I did. And God says, John, do you really want to go there? Do you want me to start listing all things you've really done? So I think you better forgive your wife and forget that. That's where I swallow my pride and I go to my wife and I ask her for forgiveness. That is what Jesus is asking all of us to do. That as we have been forgiven, we are to forgive. He sums it up in the last verse 35. So my heavenly Father will do to every one of you if you will not forgive your brother or sister from your heart. So my heavenly Father will do to you what? Throw us into the prison. Hand us over to the guards if we will not forgive. And forgive from the heart. Not be a just surface forgiveness where we continue to hold the grudge or whatever, but true forgiveness. Forgiveness from the heart. And so let us not be like the people C.S. Lewis was commenting about, thinking forgiveness is a wonderful idea until we have something to forgive. But let us remember also that God always has the light of forgiveness on. A Motel 6 may keep the light on for you, but you may end up at one that has no vacancy. So great, the light's on, but there's no room. But God's light of forgiveness never goes out. It's never full. It's never been used up. It's always available. So as we are forgiven, let us forgive one another. And let us reconcile with each other. And let us remember that so often the things we become upset about really are not that important in the larger scheme of things. Because politicians come and go, champion sports teams come and go, the trinkets of the world come and go. But salvation, because of forgiveness, is forever. And being a child of the Heavenly Father means a place in His kingdom forever. So the light, God's light of forgiveness is on. Let us take advantage of it. Peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. now sing Precious Lord, Take My Hand, hymn number 773, in the back of the worship. Hymn number 773.
Black man, Thomas Dorsey, after he found out that his wife had died and his son had died, and he wrote this song after that. Thomas Dorsey, famous black hymn writer.
Thank you.
1973, Horatio Stafford lost his entire family except for his wife as they were on a ship which was hit by another ship, and his four daughters perished and drowned when the ship sank. His wife was saved. Horatio Stafford wrote this song when he took a ship across the ocean, and at the place where his daughters died, he wrote this song. Horatio Spafford, S-P-A-F-F-O-R-D, wrote this in 1873.
Faithful when our Lord comes in his glory to finish his new creation Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Keep us from the fear of signs and terrors, and guard our hearts, O Lord, in the confidence that because we belong to you, nothing shall separate us from your love. Make your church and all who serve her faithful in their work, that the gospel may be preached, and may many drawn to the name of the Lord before the day of salvation ends. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Keep, O Lord, those entrusted with the work of protecting and defending us from the dangers of war and violence, pestilence and famine and injustice. Give us respect for the value of life, for those unborn, for children and the widowed, for the aged and infirm. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Keep us steadfast, O Lord, in the face of temptation, strong in the face of trial, and unwavering in faith, trusting in your word and doing the good works of him who called us from darkness into his marvelous light. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Keep, O Lord, the sick and all who suffer, and grant the grieving comfort and the dying peace, that in the afflictions of this mortal life, we may not doubt nor fear, but trust the Lord to provide all things needful to sustain us from illness, pain, and even death. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Keep us from being consumed by the cares of this mortal life or the fear of death. You, O Lord, have been the strength of martyrs, the peace of those who die, and the comfort of all who sorrow. Give us hope in the face of nations in distress and a world filled with upset. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
As the days pass and all things move to their appointed end, keep us from being complacent. Keep us alert and awake, so that when the day comes, we may greet the Lord and rejoice in his eternal salvation. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. And it was taught us to say when we pray, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. May the almighty and merciful Lord, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, bless, comfort, strengthen, and keep you, now and forever. Amen. We conclude our worship with Let All Things Now Living, hymn number 881, in the back of your worship. Hymn number 881.
This is a Thanksgiving hymn written by Catherine Davis, who lived 1892 to 1980, and the song is a Welsh folk tune. This is Thanksgiving, and Thanksgiving is coming up, singing a Thanksgiving hymn.
Thank you.
for watching us on YouTube. This is our November service before our Yuletide Festival. Our Yuletide Festival will be this week, if you're listening in time for this. It's Thursday, Friday, and Saturday. You'll come for lunch and for supper, Thursday and Friday. The flowers in our chancel stands are to the glory of God today, presented by Joanne Smith, in memory of her mother, Ruth Davidson's birthday, also Ted and Linda Smith, for family birthdays. We're happy that you worship with us. Pray for us, and our YouTube ministry will continue to pray for you.